Hey everybody, welcome to the Lakers Nation NewsFeed. My name is Trevor Lane, senior writer for LakersNation.com, and today is Mamba Day. In case you can't see it, if you're not watching this on YouTube, I am wearing my Kobe Bryant Mamba Day shirt right now because this is an important day for Lakers fans. Every year, August 24th, 8/24, Kobe Bryant's two numbers, Mamba Day. We're going to be celebrating everything Kobe. And joining me today to help me do just that is Hannah Kulick from Lakers Nation. Hannah, how are you doing?
I am doing great. Thank you so much for having me on about this. You know Kobe Bryant is like my favorite person in the entire world, so I am so excited to honor him tonight.
Well, I figured we had to bring you on because Kobe wound up on your fantasy team when we, on the full-length podcast, we did our all-time Lakers draft. You wound up with Kobe, and you also wound up winning the vote, so I've got to give you props for that. According to the fan vote, you won the all-time fantasy draft, so good job, Hannah.
Thank you. I'm not going to lie. It was the highlight of my week.
Yeah, I mean, hey, you can't argue with a victory over myself and Nikki Kay and Denise Jones. Always nice to pick up the W. So Kobe Bryant, today we're going to talk about just the Black Mamba, and we're going to, in fact, talk about his top five moments as a Laker, at least top five in our opinion. I know there's a lot of people who have a lot of strong opinions and strong memories of Kobe Bryant because he spent two decades playing for the Los Angeles Lakers. But we're going to talk about, at the very least, five of the best Kobe Bryant moments, even if some of the listeners have some different moments. I think the ones we've got are pretty darn good. Hannah, do you want to kick us off and introduce the first Kobe Bryant moment that we're going to talk about here?
Yes, I would love to. Okay, so number five on our list, we have Kobe Bryant winning regular season MVP during the 2007-2008 season.
So he wins the MVP award, and obviously that wasn't an easy season. I mean, his team did go all the way to the NBA Finals. They lost Andrew Bynum midseason, but then pivoted and managed to pull off a phenomenal trade, one that I will never forget, for Pau Gasol. I remember I was actually sick the day that they pulled off the trade for Pau Gasol, and I started running laps around my house. I jumped up off the couch and started running laps around the house as soon as I heard that Pau Gasol was a Laker. And they get to the NBA Finals, unfortunately lose to the Boston Celtics. But Kobe, man, he was just phenomenal that season, wasn't he?
He was absolutely unbelievable. He played in all 82 games of the season, every single game, even though he actually fractured one of his fingers on his shooting hand. He didn't even miss a second, where most players would be out for a little while. Kobe Bryant didn't miss one single game. He averaged 28 points. He shot 46% from the field. I think he grabbed like 6 rebounds, 5 assists. He shot 84% from the free throw line. He was just on fire that season. And it's crazy looking back that this is actually his only regular season MVP award. I think that's something that just, I don't quite know how to explain it, but this was a season where he was finally honored in that way.
Yeah, that was the first time that he finally got that. And it does seem weird. I mean, you would think a guy like Kobe Bryant, who was such an incredible player for such a long time, you would think he would land more MVP awards. But still, glad that he did wind up with at least one. What do you have number four on our list?
Okay, number four. I think fans are going to appreciate this one. This is when Kobe wins his fifth NBA championship, the NBA title 2010 over the Boston Celtics.
That's a great one. I love that Kobe Bryant moment. And it's a little bit weird, I think, because that game seven, Kobe wasn't all that good. Nobody else was either. I mean, the two teams shot horrendously. I mean, we're talking low 30% for both teams from the field, both the Boston Celtics and the Lakers. It was a defensive struggle. I don't know about you, Hannah, but I was on the edge of my seat the entire time. And I'll even admit, at a few points in the game, I was on my knees praying for the Lakers to finally make a comeback because the Celtics were in control all the way up until part of the way through the third quarter in that one.
Yeah, that was an unbelievable game. It was something, like you said, I mean, I was praying too. I actually still go back and watch that game. And even though no one really shot the ball well, I know Kobe shot horrendous, he ended up scoring 10 of his 23 points in the fourth quarter. So we all know Kobe. When it counts, Kobe's going to make the buckets. It doesn't matter if he's 0 for 50. If it's that fourth quarter time, if the NBA championship is on the line, Kobe Bryant is going to score some points. Metal World Peace was actually probably the real reason the Lakers ended up winning in that game. I remember him him shooting a three, and I just
That
remember
three.
jumping up and
Yep.
down. Oh my gosh, my heart, even actually just talking about it right now, my heart started beating fast. That was such an unbelievable game. And one of the highlights of that game for me is after they win, a reporter asked Kobe, "What does this championship mean?" And he says, "It means I've got one more than Shaq." Classic Kobe.
Kobe Petty. Yeah, I love that response. Oh my gosh, that Ron
Oh.
Artest Metta World Peace shot. That was incredible. It was one of those moments where when you saw him shoot, I think everybody had the same reaction. We all went, "No, don't shoot it." And then he hit it, and it was just a sigh of relief. And of course, the Lakers come home with the victory. I'll never forget Kobe running down the floor with his finger in the air, holding the game ball, and of course, jumping up on the announce table and celebrating with the Lakers fans. I mean, and the fact that it was over the Celtics too. I think out of all Kobe's championships, and he had some incredible moments in the playoffs, but that one just seemed to mean more because it was over the Boston Celtics and because of the history that those two teams have.
Oh yeah, I completely agree. When I think of even all of the Lakers championships, this is the one that is the first that comes to my mind that just feels the best. Going into a game seven at Staples Center against the Boston Celtics, beating them, nothing is better in my opinion.
All right, what do you have next for us? We've already talked about some amazing moments. What
Yeah.
can possibly top that?
Okay, number three, and this might be something that the fans might be questionable a little bit. This is when Kobe tears his Achilles on April 12th, 2013, against the Golden State Warriors, but not the tearing of the Achilles. Obviously, that's not a good
No,
Kobe Bryant moment.
that's not a positive thing.
No, we are talking about when he made those two free throws after he tore his Achilles. Trevor, I know for me at least, this is a moment I will never forget.
It was certainly a painful moment. I mean, it's a hard moment to remember for Lakers fans. It was definitely I remember where I was when moment. I vividly remember thinking, "Oh my gosh, this could be it. This could be over." I got a text from my dad who said that Achilles, that's really bad. That might be it. And I mean, there was that instant fear, but at the same time, even in his darkest moment, he was still Kobe. He still did stuff that nobody else would do because he reached down. His Achilles is torn. He's on the floor. Harrison Barnes had been defending him. Kobe asked Harrison Barnes, "Did you kick me?" Harrison Barnes says no, and Kobe instantly knew, okay, that means my Achilles is torn. He reaches down and tries to grab his Achilles and reattach it. He tried to reattach it with his hand like that was gonna work, and then he starts trying to figure out a way to just play through it. Who does that? Nobody but Kobe Bryant.
No, it's unbelievable. I mean, that's an injury. When a player tears and their Achilles, they are carried off in a stretcher. They don't A, walk off the court, and then B, go and make two free throws. Like, it's just unheard of. That entire season for Kobe Bryant, though, was just honestly unbelievable. That was when people were him as Vino because he just gets better with age. That was a season where we had brought in Dwight Howard and Steve Nash, and it was a complete disaster. And Kobe had made a promise to the fans that he was going to get us into the playoffs, and he did that. And he literally gave every single ounce of him to make sure that we got to the playoffs. And that, just him making those two free throws in that moment, having so much uncertainty, not knowing, if that's the last time you're ever going to see a basketball court or at least play in a game, being able to be calm and composed, be able to knock down those two free throws is just the complete representation of when you think of the Mamba mentality. And that is something, honestly, that moment, I will never forget it. And that is probably my biggest inspiration in my entire life is whenever I need inspiration, I think Kobe Bryant made two free throws when he tore his Achilles. You can get through this, Hannah. Push through it.
Yeah, if you remember, the Lakers were in a really tight race at that point to get into the playoffs. I mean, this was an important game against the Golden State Warriors for the Lakers to make the playoffs. They needed that win badly. So even when Bryant, he was getting dinged up all game long, but there was no chance he was coming off the floor. Unfortunately, you could kind of feel that something bad was coming. There were these sort of warning signs. He hit the floor a few times. He came up hobbling, and it didn't look good. They had really, really turned to Kobe as the season went on and just gave him a ton of minutes. He was playing to the point of exhaustion, and it was unfortunate what ended up happening. And of course, Kobe never quite hit that same level again. So ironically, the Achilles injury wound up kind of stopping Kobe from being Kobe. He wound up becoming mortal with an Achilles injury. But still, incredible that in that moment, even in his darkest moment, he steps up, hits the two free throws because that was what the team needed to win. All right, let's get on to sunnier times. Hannah, we're counting down here. Second greatest moment for Kobe Bryant. I think I've got an idea where you're gonna go with this one.
Okay, number two, and I think this is a pretty exciting moment everyone can remember, is January 22nd, 2006, where he scored 81 points against the Toronto Raptors.
That's right. I mean, incredible. Obviously, the second highest scoring total to Wilt Chamberlain, who put up 100 points in a game. Kobe Bryant, remember just a few weeks before this, he had 62 in three quarters against the Mavericks. That was a blowout win that the Lakers cruised to. So if he had played that fourth quarter, maybe he would have accomplished this a few weeks before, but in this case, or almost a month before, but in this case, Bryant was needing every single point. The Lakers needed every single point that Kobe was scoring in order to defeat the Toronto Raptors that night. Hannah, it's definitely a I remember where I was when moment for me. Do you remember where you were when that was happening, when Kobe went for 81?
Absolutely. I was 10 years old. You can imagine that. I was 10 years old and I remember being in my living room watching it with my dad, and we are just jumping up and down. We are screaming. It was just literally, it doesn't even feel like it was real because it just seemed like he couldn't miss. It just seemed like it was almost like the ball was just a magnet to the hoop and there was no way he was going to miss. He could have thrown it from outside the Staples Center and he somehow would have made it in the basket.
I still remember the announcers, the talking heads, the different NBA personalities at the time just being amazed that the Raptors didn't double Kobe or triple Kobe or do something to make anyone else score. I mean, his teammates were Smush Parker and Kwame Brown and Chris Mim, and I mean, so of course Kobe's going to be the guy that's shooting, especially when he's got it going like that. And yet they didn't do it, and Kobe explodes for 81 points. It was incredible. I actually missed the game live because it was my dad's birthday and we went out to dinner, and then I came home and I caught the very end of it and I instantly called him. I just talked to him, and so I had to call my dad and say, "Hey, Dad, you need to turn on the TV right now. Check this out." He goes, "Why? What's going on?" I said, "Kobe has scored 81 points." Oh my gosh, he freaked out right into his TV. Incredible moment. I mean, who else is gonna do that but Kobe Bryant? So amazing. What's number one on the list? I have a good feeling on this one.
Number one has to be, it just has to be the greatest moment of my entire life. It doesn't even feel real. I keep saying that about all of these moments. It doesn't feel real, Trevor, but Kobe Bryant was not a real player. I just don't think he's a real person. There will never be anyone else like him. Number one on our list is April 13th, 2016, Kobe Bryant's last NBA game, where he scores 60 points. 60.
Yeah, you know, I was thinking about this today, knowing we were going to do this show, and I was thinking about what is my favorite memory of Kobe Bryant, which one will I treasure the most? And there's so many great ones. I think about that lob to Shaq against the Blazers. You think about Kobe stepping up when Shaq fouls out in 2000, same playoff series, and he winds up bringing the team home in overtime against the Indiana Pacers in game four. You think about all these incredible moments. I think about 2004, Kobe hitting the two threes at the buzzer against Portland to first send it into overtime and then win the game at the very end of the regular season. He's had so many incredible ones, but I think this one is the one that I'll also treasure the most. Because if you look at it, look at what was going on at the time, and you think about where Kobe was just a few weeks before this, nobody would have guessed that he would score 60 points. I mean, this was the hottest ticket in town, the hardest ticket to come by. The prices were soaring in order to go to this game, and expectations were high. But Kobe Bryant looked like a mummy heading into this, right? In the weeks before, after every game, the Lakers had to wrap him up, his shoulders, his knees, his elbows, everything. He's so wrapped up that it looks like it's Halloween. I mean, they are holding him together and just keeping him vertical just long enough to finish the season. So nobody would have expected that he goes out and scores 60 points.
Exactly. And you know, the Lakers, just in general, that season, it was their worst record in franchise history. They only had 17 wins, 65 losses.
It was a
The
tough
entire
season.
team, it was a very rough season, Trevor, I'm not gonna lie. I was barely holding on there for a little while, but this game just completely made up for it. I remember going into the game, I just remember saying, I just want him to have a good game. I just want him to be able to go out there, score 20, 25, not, you know, just make maybe, you know, 45, 50% would be awesome if he could just have some sort of, you know, nice game. I don't want to embarrass, him to go out being embarrassed, because there were a lot of moments during that season where it was almost painful to watch.
Right.
I never in my
Yep.
wildest dreams thought he was going to score 60 points. And even the first half, I remember he comes out and he's not playing that well, and I'm holding my breath and I'm praying. And second half comes around, he just completely flips the switch, and it's like he's 27 all over again. It was insane.
It was. I mean, and you're right. It didn't start well. It started off very poorly. Kobe missed his first few shots. I was just like you. I was hoping that we would just see some flashes of the old Kobe. And then lo and behold, not only does he score 60 points, but they're 60 much needed points in order to win the game. No, they weren't going to the playoffs or anything like that. But I can't think of a better way to end a career that isn't in the playoffs. I mean, the way Kobe finished that, and this is why I don't think he should go play in like the big three or anything like that. There is no better ending. There's no better way to leave it aside from winning a championship. Kobe Bryant went out in the best way possible, and I don't think I've ever seen anything like that before because it wasn't, this is like something out of a movie. It wasn't even real life. If you look at what was happening in the moment, I remember the realization hitting me, oh my gosh, he's giving everything he's got left. When you're watching that, you're seeing it felt as though he was giving the last bit of basketball he had left in him to Lakers fans, to the fans that were there in attendance, to everybody that was watching. That was somebody emptying the gas tank like we've never seen before, and I think he knew what he was doing. He knew that he was giving everything his body had left in him. And I don't think we've ever seen anybody completely exhaust all the basketball talent in themselves the way that Kobe did, and then to put on that performance. Unforgettable, unbelievable. And I'm still in disbelief that it happened. I know you said on the show a couple of months ago that you still go back and you watch the highlights from that. I do as well. Every once in a while, I go back and I watch the highlights from that performance because it is unbelievable. It's certainly a memory that I'm going to treasure for a long, long time.
Exactly. And like you said, I actually remember turning to someone I was watching the game with. I was watching with one of my friends and my family, and I remember turning to them and saying, "This is what it looks like when you have given your entire heart and soul to something." I mean, he gave every single thing he had to the Lakers, to the fan base, to the franchise, and that is why he is so special. And I don't think there will ever be another player like him. Like I said, he's my hero, so I will just talk about him until I'm blue in the face. But I just truly believe there is only one Kobe Bryant, and he is an unbelievable player.
Yeah, there's going to be other stars. We know there's already another star in Los Angeles, LeBron James. There's going to be other stars because it's the Lakers. The Lakers get stars. It's what they do. Yes, they've had a drought over the last few years, but they find ways to land stars ultimately. Think about Kareem, Magic Johnson, Wilt, Jerry West. I mean, obviously Kobe, all these different players that have come in and worn the Lakers jersey. So there's going to be stars after him, but I don't think there's anybody that can replicate what he did 2 decades in purple and gold, and what he meant to Los Angeles, what he has meant to basketball fans, what he still means right now. I think that is completely untouchable, and there's no way that anyone is going to replicate that. That's why I'm not worried about LeBron James coming to town. I'm not upset that LeBron's here or anything like that because Kobe's record and resume stands for itself. Yes, other stars will come along. And yeah, Kobe's, his accomplishments are going to fade into the past a little bit. That doesn't mean they're going to be forgotten. What he has done is going to stand the test of time. And I think that's something that's really special and is really unique. So you're right. I don't think that Kobe can be matched.
No, I completely agree with you, and I feel the same way about LeBron. I know there's a lot of people who talk about that LeBron Kobe rivalry, but for me, it doesn't matter because they're different players. And LeBron is amazing. He's probably going to be, he's the best player in the game. Might even be the best player to ever play, but he's just not Kobe in my opinion. And he'll never. It's just a completely different type of player and a completely different type of mindset. So I don't compare the two. I'm not mad about LeBron coming. I don't have any, salty feelings because of Kobe, nothing like that. It's just a completely different. Kobe is in his own league, and Kobe is Kobe, and there will never be anyone like him.
Yeah, I mean, I grew up basically with Kobe. A lot of us did, right? I mean, there's a whole generation of Lakers fans who grew up watching Kobe Bryant, who grew up with him as a rookie all the way through to the end of his career. And so he left that mark that's never going to go away. And yeah, I mean that's part of why we're doing all this, to make sure that we still
Exactly.
celebrate Mama Day and remember what Kobe Bryant meant for not just this franchise, not just for the Lakers and not just for us as fans, but also for the game of basketball. I mean, really, really incredible career. And yeah, not enough good things that we can say about the one and only Kobe Bryant.
Exactly. I mean, I was that 5-year-old girl in kindergarten when all the kids were doing their project on their heroes and they were doing, whoever, Britney Spears, whatever it was at the time. I was that 5-year-old going, Kobe Bryant, and everyone just looked at me like, you are insane. And to this day, he's still my number one hero, my number one inspiration for everything. So I'm so honored to have been able to come on and do this podcast because, again, this is like Kobe Day is pretty much my version of Christmas. So it doesn't get any better for
Yeah,
me.
it is. And of course, we celebrated Kobe's 40th birthday, and now we get Mamba Day. So it's almost like 2 days in a row of Kobe. So it's so very, very cool for Lakers fans and of course basketball fans. Hannah, thank you so much for coming on here and joining me to do this. I really enjoyed this show. Always a good time when we can talk about some of these great moments with Kobe Bryant.
Of course, thank you so much for having me on, Trevor. Truly, this is a great show, and I'm so honored to have been on for this special episode.
Guys, make sure you go follow Hannah on Twitter at Hannah_Kulik. And if you want to follow me, you can follow me. I'm Trevor Lane. Follow me at Trevor_Lane. That's going to do it for today's show. We'll be back next week with a full-length Lakers Nation podcast. And of course, the Lakers Nation news feed whenever there's something big going on in the world of the Los Angeles Lakers. Make sure you guys head over to LakersNation.com, your home for everything Lakers, for all the latest Lakers news and info. And that's going to do it for now. Till next time, see ya.